The Gospel according to Luke, the first chapter. I'm going to read verses 46 through 55. This may be a bit familiar to some of you, others of you maybe not as much. Maybe you heard it and you just didn't quite remember or know what it was. But this is Mary's song. Often it is referred to as the Magnificat. I'm going to read to us this morning Luke, the first chapter, verses 46 through 55. Again, this is Mary's song. And Mary said, "My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior. For he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed. For the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name. His mercy extends to those who fear him from generation to generation. He has performed mighty deeds with his arm. He has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones, but has lifted up the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things, but has sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel, remembering to be merciful to Abraham and his descendants forever, just as he promised our ancestors." This is the word of God for you people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Would you bow with me for a word? Well, God, we thank you now for all that we have already been able to do in this place this morning. Thank you for every song that has been sang, for every word of prayer that has been offered. Thank you, O God, for the lighting of the Advent candle as we continue to prepare for your coming. Continue to prepare to celebrate your birth. We thank you, O God, for the opportunity to give this morning and to give generously from our hearts in order that your kingdom might continue to be uplifted and built. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for the passing of the peace, for the opportunity to touch each other, to greet each other, for the opportunity to be like you, Jesus. But we know that you are God that touches the untouchable, God that loves the unlovable, God that will do for us what we cannot do for ourselves. Thank you for all that gather in this place this morning. We pray, O God, still understand that lest the preacher comes, there can be no preaching in this place. So come on, Holy Ghost, and have thine own way. Speak, Lord, for we, your people, are listening. Speak, Lord, we, your people, are listening. We pray this prayer in all of our lives. In the sweet, sweet name of the living God. Lord, he is your son and your daughters. Say amen.
Amen.
Amen. And amen. So again, our text this morning comes from the Gospel of Luke. Luke, the first chapter, verses 46 through 55. So, it is but a few weeks before Christmas. And all of us know that there are so many, too many things that are not right in our world. Mass shootings have been rampant this year. The number of resignations and people being fired because of sexual misconduct is absolutely outrageous. People continue to be hungry. People continue to be homeless. Racial profiling is prolific. We look to the news, and even though our country and administration has said that it has been their desire to promote peace in the Middle East, we see that even this past week with designating Jerusalem as the new capital of Israel, that peace is what is it happening in that part of the world. When we look at our text this morning, I was interested in Ida's rendition of the bulletin this morning where she said that this is the first Christmas carol. And I think that her interpretation is actually quite right. It is one of the first Christmas carols because Mary is singing as she magnifies God. And so this text that we have read this morning in the midst of all of the chaos in our world reminds us that chaos was going on in the world of a young woman named Mary also. And yet in the midst of all of the chaos and all that is going on, Mary sings a song. Now if you decide to go back and you read the verses or the passage right before the passage that I have read to us this morning, you might know that Mary has gone to visit her cousin Elizabeth. Elizabeth is a woman who has been considered cursed much of her life because she has not been able to bear children. So Elizabeth is an older woman, but now she finds herself pregnant. And Mary, too, is pregnant. Mary is poor. She's a teenager. She's not married. And she is a mother-to-be. And yet these two marginalized, pregnant women carry the very future of the world in their wombs as they open their mouths in praise and proclamation of this baby that Elizabeth will bear named John the Baptist, who has been termed and considered the forerunner, for he goes on to prepare the way for the Messiah as he preaches in the wilderness. Now in the midst of rejection and isolation, it blows my mind that these women still have joy. They have joy and they have hope, y'all, a joy and a hope that some of us don't even begin to understand. And every time I read, every time I hear their story and I hear and I read about their hope, it stirs hope within me for their faith. Their faith sharpens my faith. And I think about, and I think I even may have said to you before, maybe not with this text, maybe a different text, but when I hear their story, I think about that old song that says, "Happy, good, 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 happy, good down in my soul." Every time I think about Jesus, I feel good, I feel good, I feel things,
that wrote and sang, "I feel good." Mary was not singing about the things that were going on around her. She was not singing about what she saw, nor was she singing about all that she was experiencing. For how can I begin to imagine the fear and the bewilderment, the shock that must have entered into her sphere as the angel comes to her and tells her that she is highly favored, and then tells her that she, a virgin, an unmarried woman, will have a child who will be holy, a child who will be called the Son of the Most High God, a child who will be the Messiah. No, Mary. Mary is not singing about what she sees around her. Instead, Mary is singing about the promises of the God that created the world, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. She is singing about the promises of the God that spared the firstborn of every Israelite, the God that led the Hebrews out of the land of Egypt, the God that was a cloud by day and fire by night, the God that provided manna and quail and water from a rock in a dry and desert land, the God that said, "I will write my word on your heart and I will be your God and you will be my people." Mary sings about the God that promises and proclaims possibility when the world says that there is no possibility. When the world says you might as well give up, hang your head, go home and die. For she says, "He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich Mary sings of a God who brings fulfillment. Now many, if not all of us, would not consider ourselves as lonely as Mary did or as lonely as the world treated those who sang the song, "I Feel Good." And to model this little 13-year-old girl. And faithfully speak things that are not yet so as if they were already so. I wonder how many of us will believe and trust Luke's proclamation that nothing shall be impossible for God. For if you believe that this morning, whatever your situation, whatever your circumstance, trust that God is the one that holds the future, even if you are not able to yet. I trust and I pray that God will help you, that he will help me get to a place where we can give God our right now and an anyhow praise. A praise for all things, but a praise in all things. See, I believe my forebears, I think they were able to see. I feel good deep down in my soul. Because they also wrote and sang a song that says, trouble don't last always. We may endure through the night, but joy, y'all. Joy comes in the morning.
Yes.
Some of our nights are a little longer than other nights. But joy comes in the morning. Sure, some folks experience a whole lot more suffering than others. And yet the very birth of Christ, God incarnate, God with us, reminds us that God came to turn the world upside down. Not just our world, but the world upside down. I believe Elizabeth, Mary, and those who rolled and sang, I feel good. I think they sang because they understood that they were and that they are a part of something larger than themselves and their individual lives. And as we discover our place in this larger story, I pray that we hope, that we sing, that we praise God, not only for but that we praise God in all things. In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the blessed Holy Spirit, people of God shall say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. And amen. Amen. Those God's church are open today. And they're open not because I say so, or because any preacher says so. But the doors of God's church are open because God says, I love you. God says, I need you. God says, I will put you. God says, the way that I judge is not the way that the world judges. The world may look at you and say you are poor, uneducated, too young, a little girl, a mother, a single mother, who is unmarried. And yet God says, you are my choice. You are my choice. You are my choice. We're talking about partiality in our Bible study this past week. And recognizing that we show favoritism. We show favoritism. We show partiality based on what people look like, based on where they went to school, based on where they live, based on what church they are part of, based on all of their accolades. And yet God's favoritism is not based on any of those things. That God will choose whomever God wishes to choose, not because God loves him or her anymore, but because God says, I choose you to be a light, to be a vessel to the world, to tell the world about my son named Jesus. God loves you, y'all. And whatever it is that you make up your mind that you want to walk boldly, you want to walk boldly with your God, and you come, you have a conversation with me, and we will talk the more about what it means to walk with our God. If I'm not available, you need to go to him on yourself. See, that's the thing about Jesus Christ. He's the only mediator that we need. You don't need me. All you need to do